Svante Arrhenius was a Swedish scientist who played pioneering roles in the developments of physical chemistry and climate science. He went to his hometown university at Uppsala, where, after passing his candidacy exam, he needed to find a supervisor for his doctoral research project. However, he chose not to study with the professors at Uppsala. Robert Thalén, professor of physics, had taken over his position from Anders Engström and was mainly interested in continuing Engström's studies of the solar spectrum. Per Theodor Kleve, professor of chemistry, among other studies, had discovered the elements holmium and thallium, but he was much less interested in the theoretical aspects of chemistry that inspired Arrhenius. Thus, Arrhenius chose to make the short trip to Stockholm, where he worked in the laboratories of Professor of Physics Erik Edlund. Here, Arrhenius chose to investigate the conductivities of compounds in solution, with a view to see if he could find a correlation between molecular weight and conductivity. Soon, he noted that the change in conductivity on dilution was not the same for all compounds. Later, he would understand that this was due to the greater dissociation of some compounds, such as salts, but in his thesis, he merely noted there was a subkind of reaction going on. Arrhenius believed his results to be very important, but his examiners were Cleve and Thalén, and they only gave him a low mark. Later, Scottish chemist Sir James Walker wrote how baffled he was to see such a decision from a historically important institution. Afterwards, Arrhenius began writing to other physical chemists, including Wilhelm Ostwald, whom he maintained a lifelong friendship. Ostwald was impressed with Arrhenius' thesis and supported his application for a fellowship to study in Europe. Later, Arrhenius exchanged letters with Dutch physical chemist Jacobus van 't Hooft, also maintained a long friendship with Wilhelm Ostwald. Van 't Hooft had noticed that the osmotic pressures of salt solutions did not show the same behavior as other solutions, such as those of sugars. At this point, Arrhenius realized that his and Van 't Hooft's results could best be explained if it was assumed that salts, strong acids, and strong bases all dissociate completely to ions in dilute solution. Thus, when Arrhenius published this result in 1887, he described acids as H plus ion donors in solution, and bases as OH minus ion donors in solution. He further noted that this explained why the heat of neutralization was always the same for different dilute acids and bases. After Arrhenius published this, other important developments would almost immediately occur. For example, in 1888, Ostwald explained Arrhenius' results theoretically with his law of dilution. Then in 1889, Walter Nernst would devise a famous equation in which the dependence of electrode potentials on solution equilibrium data was established. 2 years earlier, in fact, Nernst and Arrhenius had spent time together in the group of Austrian physicist Ludwig Boltzmann, and they would remain on best terms for several years until they had a falling out. In the meantime, in a second development of Van 't Hooft's theoretical work, Arrhenius devised an equation which allows reaction activation energies to be calculated. It wasn't long, however, until he broadened his horizons. Thus, in 1896, he showed how changes in atmospheric carbon dioxide levels can result in global temperature changes. The work followed on from studies by other notable scientists. For example, Joseph Fourier had shown that solar rays can pass through the atmosphere and become trapped inside as heat. Later, Eunice Foote, an American amateur scientist, had shown that carbon dioxide absorbs heat better than other gases and had noted that changes in the atmospheric composition can therefore result in global temperature changes. Irish physicist John Tyndall, in a more detailed and wide-ranging investigation, came to a similar conclusion a few years later. However, it was Arrhenius who first calculated the temperature changes that would result from certain changes in atmospheric carbon dioxide levels. As a resident and native of Sweden, he was interested in the causes of ice age advances and retreats. He calculated that changing the atmospheric carbon dioxide level by a factor of 3 would suffice. In fact, his calculations were off by a factor of about 2. This was still an impressive result, coming as it did approximately 130 years ago. A couple of months after Arrhenius reported these results, the Swedish chemist, engineer, and inventor of dynamite, Alfred Nobel, died and left the bulk of his fortune for the establishment of the Nobel Awards. This gave Arrhenius some new responsibilities and opportunities. For example, he became involved in early decisions about selecting chemistry and physics Nobel laureates. Notably, Van't Hoft, Arrhenius and Ostwald's early recipients, whereas Nernst didn't receive his Nobel Prize for Chemistry until much later. Arrhenius also became director of the newly funded Nobel Institute for Physical Chemistry. In later years, while working at the Institute, he continued to diverge from his original studies and would later publish textbooks on immunochemistry and cosmic physics. His contributions to these areas, however, did not have the same impact or importance as his original studies on the nature of solution, the effect of atmospheric carbon dioxide, and global temperatures. Thank you so much for listening to the very end, and I hope to see you again sometime soon.